Okay, so good afternoon to all and welcome to lecture number 24. Yesterday we started new chapter, that is chapter number 4, time domain analysis, and we studied standard test signals which are used for doing the analysis of a control system in time domain. So there are basically 4 standard test signals are there. One is your impulse signal, another one is step signal, third signal is your ramp signal, and fourth signal is a parabolic signal. So impulse signal signifies the sudden jerk or sudden shock. Okay, so if you would like to test the system for sudden jerk or sudden shock, then you can use the impulse signal. Then step signal signifies the sudden change. So if you would like to test the system for sudden change kind of input, then you have to use a step signal. And then for a constant velocity, you can use a ramp signal because it signifies the constant velocity. And then for a constant acceleration, you can use the parabolic signal. So it signifies the constant acceleration and so on. So this is what we have studied in yesterday's talk. Now we'll study further in this. Okay, what is by time domain analysis, what is by transient response, what is by transient part and steady state part, and then how it is tested, and then we'll study some part of first order system and so on. So what is by order of the system and what is by type of the system and so on, right? So now this is basically a unit parabolic signal when a is equal to 1. So in this, p of t will be equal to unit parabolic signal and so on. So this is basically the relation between standard test signals. Like, for example, we have studied the impulse signal, step signals. These are the 4 standard test signals which are used in time domain analysis. So impulse is represented as delta t is equal to a for t is equal to 0. Otherwise, it will be having magnitude equal to 0 for t is not equal to 0. Whereas step signal is represented by u of t, okay, which is equal to a when t is greater than or equal to 0. Otherwise, it will be having the magnitude equal to 0 for t is less than 0. So this is step signal. Whereas ramp signal, okay, ramp signal is basically r of t, which is represented mathematically as a into t when t is greater than or equal to 0. Otherwise, it will be having amplitude equal to 0 for t is less than 0. So this is the ramp signal. And the parabolic signal is given by p of t is equal to a t square by 2. And then this one, when t is greater than or equal to 0, otherwise, okay, if it is 0, for t is less than or equal to 0. Now here, you can say unit step input if value of a is equal to 1, or unit ramp input if value of a is here 1, and unit parabolic signal when value of a is equal to 1. Now, what is the relation between the impulse signal, step signal, ramp signal, and so on? So if you integrate this impulse signal, you get the step signal. If you integrate the step signal, you get the ramp signal. And if you integrate the ramp signal, you get the parabolic signal. So integration of this impulse, you will get the unit step signal or step signal. Integration of this step signal, you will get the this one, ramp signal. Again, integration of this ramp signal, you will get the parabolic signal. Now, if you go in the reverse order, if you differentiate parabolic signal, you will get the ramp signal. Again, if you differentiate ramp signal, you will get the step signal. Or if you differentiate step signal, you will get the impulse signal and so on. So if you go in this direction, so differentiation relation will be there. And if you go in this direction, okay, integration relation will be there among all those signals. So d by dt, if you take the differentiation of parabolic signal, you'll get the ramp signal. Again, if you differentiate this ramp signal with respect to t, you will get the step signal. Again, if you differentiate this step signal with respect to t, you'll get the impulse signal. I hope that you have understood the relation between all those signals, means impulse and step is If you take the integration of impulse, you'll get the step. Or if you take the differentiation of step, you'll get the impulse. Similarly, if you take the integration of step, you'll get the ramp. And if you take the differentiation of ramp, you'll get the step signal, and so on. So by that way, there is a relation between standard test signals, right? Now, let us look at what is this Laplace transform of the test signal, because this is widely used whenever we are going to study the transient response as well as steady state response and so on. So you know that impulse response or impulse signal is given by d of t, delta of t is equal to a when t is equal to 0, and it is 0 when t is not equal to 0. Now, okay. So if you take the Laplace transform of this one, already you people have studied this in second chapter and also in your second year of engineering mathematics. So this Laplace transform of this impulse signal is equal to a. Okay, whereas Laplace transform of this step signal is, see that in time domain, step signal is defined as u of t is equal to a when t is greater than or equal to 0, and it is 0 when t is less than 0. If you take the Laplace transform of this u of t, then this will be equal to a by s. Okay, so a by s. Now, if a is equal to 1, then it is called as the unit step in, signal, and the Laplace transform unit step signal is 1 by s. Okay, if you take one a as a 1 here, then it is called as the unit impulse signal, and then Laplace transform unit impulse signal will be 1. Laplace transform unit step signal will be 1 by s. Now, a ramp signal in time domain, it is defined as r of t is equal to a into t, and when t is greater than or equal to 0, and it is 0 when t is less than 0. Now, if you take the Laplace transform of this ramp signal, then you will get a by s square, because Laplace transform of t is nothing but 1 by s square, so is a is constant, and so it will be a by s square. Now, if value of a is 1, then it is called as the unit ramp signal, so Laplace transform of ramp signal, unit ramp signal is 1 by s square. Similarly, the parabolic signal is defined in time domain as a p of t is equal to a t square by 2 for t is greater than or equal to 0, and it is 0 for t is less than 0. If you take the Laplace transform of t square by 2, because a is constant, so this will be equal to a by s cube. Now, if a is 1, then it is called as unit parabolic signal, so it will be 1 by s cube. Now, look at this one. See, the Laplace transform of unit impulse response is 1. Laplace transform unit step is 1 by s. Then Laplace transform of unit ramp signal is 1 by s square. And then Laplace transform of unit parabolic signal is 1 by s square. So for remembering the Laplace transform of impulse, step, ramp, and parabolic is very easy. Impulse Laplace transform is 1. Then step signal is 1 by s square. I'm talking about unit step signal, unit impulse signal, and unit ramp signal, and unit parabolic signal. So unit impulse signal, Laplace transform is 1. Unit step signal, Laplace transform is 1 by s square. Unit ramp signal, Laplace transform is 1 by s square. Unit parabolic Laplace transform is 1 by s cube. So 1, 1 by s, 1 by s square, and 1 by s cube. So you can remember the Laplace transform of the standard test signal, which will be widely used for transient analysis and steady state analysis and so on in time domain analysis. Now, what in by time response of the system? Basically, when you are measuring the output for a given input, and then you are measuring output with respect to time, means your independent variable is time and dependent variable is basically response. So you are measuring that response of a system with respect to time. So time is taken as an independent parameter. So that dynamic response is called as a time response. And you know that. So for example, a simple system is that when you start any system, like for example, you have started, you must be knowing about the motor which is used generally for lifting the water at our house. Okay. When you start that motor, do you think that, specification of that motor is suppose, for example, 3000 RPM, Okay, so motors revolves with a speed of 3000 RPM. So when you start that motor, will it immediately go to 3000 speed, or it will take some time and it may go beyond that 3000 and then again it will come to the steady state value? What is your opinion? Does it go okay when you start any button, or on off on when you make that button on? So your motor will reach to 3000 RPM immediately, or it will take some time? What is your opinion?
It will take time, sir.
It will take time. Okay, and then so it will take some time to reach to the final value, and after that, so it may happen that it may extend, go beyond 3000, again it will come down, and then it will try to be at this one steady state value, and so on. So the time response of a dynamic system response, time response of a dynamic system response to an input expressed as a function of time. Okay, so when you are giving any response, any input to this system, so you'll get the output, and then it is measured with respect to time, and so on. So this time response of any system has a two component, because it will have some oscillations, and then after that it will reach to steady state value. Okay, so this overall time response is divided into two part. One is transient part and another one is steady state part. So what is by transient part and what is by steady state part? See that this one, this is the response of first order system, first order control system, and you know that. So for example, this is designed for giving the output equal to 5 volt. Like for example, you have designed a voltage regulator which will give you 5 volt output. So definitely it will start from zero, and then it will reach to this desired value. It will not immediately reach. It will take some time. So time may be, suppose for example, in seconds, or nowadays sophisticated systems are designed, so it will be in millisecond or microsecond, and so on. But it will take some time to reach to the desired value. So the time taken by the system to reach the desired value, see, this is the desired value, and this is the blue line of this one graph shows the actual value, and then this line shows the desired value. So when you apply input to this system, your system will be excited by the input, and then that output, that system will give the output. So that input is called as the excitation, and output is called as the response of that system. So when the response of the system, it changed from equilibrium, it takes some time to settle down. So it was equilibrium initially, and then it will take some time to settle down, and this is called as the, so time taken by the system to reach the steady state value is called as the transient time or transient part. And then this part beyond this one is called as the steady state part. So this is called as the, this is, this part is called as the transient parts, and then the response of the system after transient response is called as the steady state response. So see that this response is called as the steady state response, means response after 14 will be, we can call it as a steady state response, and response before 14 second we can call it as a transient response, because it is going from equilibrium value to the steady state value. So time required by that system to reach the steady state value, the response up to that point is called as the transient response, and response beyond transient response is called as the steady state response. So overall time response of the system consists of two part. One is up to this one, it is called as the transient part, and above this one it is called as the steady state part, right? So this is basically the response of the first order system. Now look at this second order system. So this is basically a transient response, and this is called as the steady state response. So in transient response, basically there are various parameters, like as how much time it takes from reaching to the steady state value. So that is called as this settling time, how much time it takes to reach the first peak value, it is called as the peak time, and so on. And so we'll see in our second order system, next slide, we'll see what kind of different indices are there which can be measured from the time response. Whereas this response, see here, it is called as the steady state response, so which basically signifies the accuracy. Steady state response signifies the accuracy, how much accurate your system is, that you will come to know from the steady state response. So if your steady state output is exactly matching with the desired value or expected value, and if there is no error, then your system accuracy will be better. Otherwise, suppose for example, desired value is 5 and your response is settling at 4.8. So your output is settling at 4.8 and it's not reaching to the, even if your time goes on increasing up to infinity. So this value of output remains 4.8. So always there will be error of 5 minus 4.8 that is equal to 0.2 volt error will be there. So that is called as the error signal or steady state error. Okay, so see here, like for example, this is the response of second order system. Now, what is meant by first order system, what is meant by second order system, that we are going to study in our next slide. So here, see that this is the source. For example, this is the second order system response. This this is the standard value or desired value. So this one is the standard value, and then this thick graph is the actual value of the system. So when it started, it is going to reach the desired value, but sometimes it go beyond that one again, it comes back again, it and so on, and it remains in this one. So see that this part, okay, this part of the system is called as the transient part, and this part of the system response is called as the steady state part. So overall, there are two parts of the response. One is transient response, transient part, and another part is called as the steady state part. So in transient part, what kind of terms or what kind of indices are there? So see that this TS is nothing but the settling time. So time required by the system to reach and stay within a allowable tolerance. Suppose for example, we have designed a voltage regulator of 10 volt, but we are happy with, like for example, if your output voltage is around 9.8 or if it go beyond 10, like as a 10.2, so plus or minus 0.2 acceptable for us. So that is called as the tolerance band. Now see that, suppose for example, this system is designed for giving the output equal to 1, and then its output goes beyond, sometimes it goes beyond 1, sometimes it goes less than 1, and so on. But this is within the tolerance band, so time required by the system to reach and stay within a tolerance band is called as the settling time. Okay, whereas this TP is nothing but the peak time of the system. So this peak time is defined as the time required by the system to reach the first peak value of the system. So this is nothing but the peak time. So time required by the system to reach its first peak value is called as the peak time. Whereas this TR is nothing but the rise time. So there are some certain important characteristic in transient part, or it is called as the indices. So that basically gives you information how fast that system is. See that when you say that, let us talk about this rise time. So rise time is the system, time required by the system to reach from zero value to 100% of its value in case of second order system, okay, or in case of 50%, first order system, it may reach up to 90% or like that. So time required by the system to reach its 100% value first time is called as the rise time, or time required by the system to reach its 50% value is called as the delay time. So there are various times, like as a delay time, rise time, peak time, and settling time. So delay time is nothing but the time required by the system to reach its 50% value. Rise time is time required by the system to reach its 100% value. Or peak time is the time required by the system to reach its first peak value. And TS is nothing but the settling time. This is the time required by the system to reach its response in allowable tolerance and stay within a tolerance. So that time is called as the settling time. So the response up to settling time is called as the transient response, and response beyond the settling time is called as the steady state response. So in one more parameter is there in transient response, that is MP, which is called as the maximum peak overshoot. So how much maximum peak is there beyond the desired value? See, so for example, if you are system goes out, system output goes far away from the desired value, then it may happen that system may get burned. So we have to control this maximum peak also while designing the control system also. So how many parameters are there in the transient part? One is there are four times, okay, there are four time parameter. One is delay time, rise time, peak time, and settling time. And one more parameter is that the maximum peak overshoot. So there are five important parameter in the transient part that we have to estimate, whereas in this steady state part, so this is basically this black line is nothing but the desired value, and then this thick black line is nothing but the actual value. So desired value minus actual value is nothing but the error. If desired value and actual value is same, then this is zero error. But if there is a difference, so that error may be positive error or that error may be negative error. So from steady state part, we can estimate the accuracy of the system, okay, by calculating the error, steady state error of that system and so on. And then see this two dotted lines are given here. So that is nothing but the tolerance band. How much tolerance band? 5% tolerance band is given, or 2% tolerance band is given, or so on. So like that way. So if you want a more accurate system, so tolerance band will be reduced. If you want, again, not more accurate, then you can increase the tolerance band and so on. So from overall, this transient response, this is called as the time response of the system. So total time response consists of two parts. One is transient part and another one is steady state part. From transient part, we can estimate five parameters. From steady state part, we can estimate one parameter. Now, from transient part, what we will know, what we'll come to know? From transient part, we will come to know about the speed of the system. Like, for example, if settling time is less, means your system is reaching to the steady state value early. But if settling time is more, then your system is said to be sluggish because it is taking a lot of time to reach its steady state value. So from this transient parameters, we will come to know about system speed, how fast your system is there. So that information you will come to know from the transient parameter or transient response indices. Whereas this steady state part, what you are going to calculate? You are going to calculate the steady state error. So from steady state part, you will come to know how much error is there in the system output. If system output exactly matches with the desired result or desired value, then error will be zero. But if it is deviated from the desired value, then there will be error. So from steady state part, we can say that we can calculate the accuracy of the system. And from transient part, we can say that we can calculate the speed of the system. So from transient part, you'll come to know about the speed. And from transient part, steady state part, you'll come to know about the accuracy of the system. So overall time response of the system consists of two parts. One is transient part and another is a steady state part. So transient part is up to the time, settling time, and beyond settling time, it is called as the steady state part, right? So I hope that you have understood what is meant by time response, what is meant by transient part, what is by steady state part, what kind of parameters are estimated in transient part, what kind of parameters or indices are estimated in the in the steady state part, and so on. So we have to estimate all those parameters, and from that we have to do the analysis of the system, like how fast your system is or how sluggish your system is there, how accurate your system is there. So from transient response or time response, you will come to know about the system accuracy as well as system speed, right? So time response of a control system, like transient response, depends upon the system poles only. So this response, transient response, depends upon the system poles, right? So keep in mind, transient response depends on the system poles only and not on the type of input. It is therefore sufficient to analyze the transient response using step input. So transient response can be analyzed by using step input, whereas the steady state response depends on system dynamics and system quantity also. So it is then examined by using different test signals. So when you are doing the analysis of transient part, you can use standard test signal as a step signal, and for doing the analysis of steady state part, you have to use the different signal, like for example step signal, you have to use ramp signal, and you have to use the parabolic signal, and so on. Then you have to see if sometime it may happen that there is no error in the for when you apply the step signal, but there, okay, like for example, if you change the input from step to ramp, then okay, earlier there was no error, but there may be a constant error because of ramp input. Or sometime it may happen that okay, instead of step or ramp, if you apply parabolic input, then your steady state error may reach to infinite value, and so on. So what kind of input you are applying depends on that one, your steady state error will be there. So steady state error depends upon the system dynamics as well as input, whereas transient part depends only on the poles of that system. And this response can be estimated by using simple step unit step input. So for doing the analysis of transient part, you have to use the unit step input, or for doing the analysis of steady state part, you have to use the unit step, you have to use the unit ramp, you have to use the unit parabolic signal, and so as an input, and so on. I hope that you have understood this part. Now, like for example, what is by order of the system and what is by type of the system? I think we have studied in our earlier chapter, like highest power of S is called as the order of the system. And if you take the S common, so highest power of S, common S, is called as the type of the system. Here highest power of S in the denominator is 1, so this is called as the first order system. So for example, the transfer function of the system is given by C of S by R of S, which is equal to K by T of S plus 1. So what is the power of S? 1. So what is the order of that system? 1. Right, so this is the first order system. Now K is nothing but the system gain, and this time T, capital T, is nothing but the time constant of the system. So how much time it takes to the reach the steady state value is decided by the time constant T. Okay, so look at this one. So where K is the DC gain of the system and capital T is nothing but the time constant of the system, and the time constant is a measure of how quickly a first order system responds to the unit step. Means when you apply the unit step input, okay, how much time it takes to reach the steady state value. So this is decided by the time constant. If time constant is more, it will take a lot of time to reach the steady state value. If time constant is less, then it will reach to the steady state value quickly, and so on. So it depends how you are designing that system, and so on. Whereas K is nothing but the system gain, and so on. Right. So DC gain of the system is the ratio between the input signal and the steady state value of the output. So that is given by the DC gain, which is nothing but the K. Right. Now look at this one. This example is given. So which is, okay, what is the gain of the system and what is the time constant of the system? So definitely this is nothing but the gain. So 10 is the DC gain of the system, and 3 is the, because value of T is 3, so time constant of the system is 3 seconds. Okay, and okay, so this is first order system, and so on. Now for the following system, okay, what is the gain and what is the time constant of the system? Can somebody tell me?
DC gain is 3 and time constant is 1.
Okay, time constant is 1. Okay, and DC gain is 3? Okay. Just compare here in what form we have written here. It is 1 plus S form. Is this in 1 plus S form? This no, transfer sir. Function is given in 1 plus S form?
No, sir.
No. We have to modify it now?
Yes, sir.
So how to modify it? So when you'll get 1 plus S form? Dividing by what factor?
5.
So you have to divide numerator as well as denominator, every term, by 5, no?
Yes.
So what will be the DC gain then?
3 by 5.
3 by 5. And what will the time constant? 1 by 5. Now, which system will be more faster? This system or this system? 1 by 5 will be less or 3 will be less? Because this time constant is 3, here time constant will be 1 by 5, right? Yes. So DC gain of this system is 3 by 5 and time constant is 1 by 5, right? So this is all about how to find out the time constant and the DC gain of the system. Tomorrow we'll see what is the response of the first order system for various kind of input, like for example, step input and ramp input and parabolic input, and then how it behaves, what is the steady state error for the first order system, and so on. So I hope that tomorrow we'll finish the first order system, and then syllabus for your midterm examination will be up to first order system, and then after midterm examination we'll start the second order system, response of second order system. So this okay, we'll stop here. If you have any doubt, I'll be happy to answer your questions. Okay, over to you.